Questions, and the first question goes to Mike Bossio, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And thank you for being here, Mr. Ferguson, and all the rest of you as well. We really appreciate you coming to present at our committee today. In the 2011 audit report, the Office of the Auditor General set out four structural impediments that limit the delivery of public services to First Nation communities. The lack of clarity about service levels, a lack of a legislative base, lack of appropriate funding mechanism, and a lack of organizations to support local service delivery. What changes in practices and approaches should the federal government take to address these structural impediments?
I think the first thing that I'd like to say on that is, you know, in 2011, what we were doing was we were looking back, right? Because we were noticing that even though departments were trying to follow up and trying to put in place responses to the recommendations we had made in past audits, the results weren't changing, right? The results on the First Nations weren't changing. So we were trying to figure out why is that? Why can there be things that are going on, but the results aren't, you know, there's no improvement in the results? So we identified those four impediments, and essentially, you know, I think the first thing is the government needs to be aware of those four impediments and then try and deal with them. When we did the audit that I mentioned in my opening statement, or the study and audit, I guess, looking at the British Columbia First Nations Health Authority, we looked at that because that was an organization that was able to get established, and we wanted to identify how they dealt with these four impediments to show, and in fact, they were successful in overcoming these four impediments. So it is possible, you know, again, with the will of everybody involved, to find ways around these and therefore provide, you know, come to an agreement and come to a better solution on some of these services. So really, I think the first thing is awareness. The second thing is making sure that the will is there on the part of everybody involved, the government, provincial government if needed, and the First Nations governments as well. Make sure the will is there on the part of everybody involved and the commitment is there, and then find ways around these four impediments that we've identified.
Okay, and so you found that the use of contribution agreements to fund the delivery of services on First Nations reserves can lead to delays in funding, uncertainty about the level of funding, and the lack of clarity about who is accountable for achieving improved outcomes or specific levels of services. What changes in the funding mechanisms should occur?
So if I can, Mr. Chair, I'll start with the response and then I'll ask Mr. Martyr to speak in particular to what we found on, you know, in the audit we did on policing services. You know, the issue here is making sure that there is some certainty of funding. You know, when you're trying to provide services to people and you have a responsibility to provide those types of services, some certainty about what the funding is going to be. You know, we found that sometimes these contribution agreements aren't put in until late in the year, so how can you know what types of services to provide? But I'll ask Mr. Martyr perhaps to expand on that, because it was particularly, I think, something that we found in the audit of policing on remote First Nations.
Okay. Thank you, and thank you for the question. As the Auditor General indicated, this is one of the issues that was problematic for the communities that were under the policing agreements. And most of them were one-year agreements, and it made it very difficult for them to plan if they didn't know when whether the agreement itself was going to be renewed. When we did the audit, we actually noted that at the end of March, there was a number of communities that were affected by these policing programs that still hadn't received the funding, and that the agreement would be put in place. So it caused a lot of problems for them in terms of knowing, you know, going forward, and whether they even had to lay people off or whatnot. So these contributions agreements, they range from 1 to 5 year, depending on the type of agreements, but the vast majority of them are 1 year contribution agreements. So it makes it difficult for people to plan and have some certainty about the level of funding they can expect to provide the services under those agreements.
Do I still have time?
A little over 2 minutes left.
Okay, good. So if we look at the funding mechanism today, it's a grant, and you know, portion of the funding is grants, and a portion of the funding is operational. And so, would you agree that if you were to eliminate the grant aspect of funding, this contribution nature of funding, and put it into more of an operational, where you say, okay, this is the level of funding that you have. You establish the priorities that are important to your communities, because we see that there is such a broad range of priorities across all reserves, all nations. Would you agree that that would be a very good step towards solving some of these funding issues?
So as auditors, we don't try and prescribe sort of, the policy that should be put in place or, exactly how the department should resolve the issues. We make recommendations, and I think in terms of funding, you know, we're not trying to prescribe a specific way of dealing with the funding issue. What we're trying to say is that there needs to be certainty with the funding. There needs to be a way that the different services can be planned for the long term, and regardless sort of how that's done, it's more the end result, that there's certainty and there's, you know, an environment whereby that long-term planning can be done. That's important from our perspective.
And how would changing the fund? Do I still have time? Okay.
1 minute left.
How would changing the funding mechanism provide greater certainty about the level of funding and clarity about who is accountable for achieving improved outcomes?
Well, when in a funding agreement, if what you are dealing with is, you know, multiple year funding, in the case again of the British Columbia First Nations Health Authority, they put in place a 10-year agreement. And in that agreement, they also had a number of years of an escalator. So the BC First Nations Health Authority knows how much money it's going to get over that 10 years, knows how that's going to escalate. So that allows them to do that type of planning, and then, you know, within that agreement, if you know what the services are that are supposed to be delivered, you know what the time frame is, and you know how the funding is going to be delivered, then you have all the bases that you need in order to have the accountability.
Thank you very much, Mr.